This evening we got Johnny Van Holb. He's better known as Johnny Liberty. Johnny is the author of the best-selling selling Reclaim Your Sovereign Citizenship, published by Cascadian Resource Center. He is a whole system educator, researcher, and network organizer offering a comprehensive and detailed history of law, economics, and policy. He's taught hundreds of seminars across the U.S. of A. for thousands of American citizens from all walks of life. Please join me in welcoming Johnny Liberty. Thank you, Johnny.
Yeah, there we go.
Well, thank you, everybody, for coming out tonight for another Granada Forum. Fortunately, I got here tonight without any incident and wasn't dragged out of my car or any other possible thing that could happen, even though my last trip to California, I did have my car impounded 2 times in 3 days, and I did have a difficult time getting where I was going. But this trip has been without incident. So I thank you, Southern California, for allowing me to get here to address you tonight. I hail out of Oregon, and I'm an Oregon state citizen, a sovereign citizen of the Oregon Republic. Thank you. And I began this work not that long ago, about 3 years ago, and I had attended a workshop of a man who was talking about money and how money systems work. He actually was a black man who had studied the Emancipation Proclamation, who was also an Oregon state citizen. And he began to open my eyes to some of the historical facts that had been neglected and ignored in American history. And it piqued my eyebrows and my interest, and I said, oh, that's very interesting. I want to find out more for myself. And so over the course of the last 3 years, I have participated in in-depth research and study and education and have synthesized many, many of the independent researchers that have been involved in this patriot movement for 30 or 40 years. And that's the source of my inspiration and the source of my inspiration and information as well. So I want to acknowledge everyone who has come before me and those who have blazed the trail, many of them who may be sitting in this room right now, who may have been involved in this work much longer than I have. So thank you very much, everybody, for your contribution. Now, tonight, the title of this talk is Reclaiming Your Sovereign Citizenship, and I use that as a broad subject to talk about all kinds of things, including sovereignty, citizenship, American history, and how political, economic, and legal systems actually work. Now, as Ralph had mentioned in the introduction, my background is as a whole systems educator. So what I'm able to do is take very complicated material and articulate it in such a fashion that people can actually understand what is going on. Because most people, unfortunately, not necessarily the people in this room, most people don't have a clue what is happening in this country. That they get most of their information from the media, or they get it from the newspaper or the television, or they learned about such and such in their history books or in their higher education, but unfortunately didn't really get the whole picture. So tonight, I would like to provide an overview of the research and the education that I've discovered over the last 3 years and present it comprehensively for all of you so that I can inspire you and empower you to take the next step in this whole movement of reclaiming our sovereignty, restoring our citizenship, restoring the republic, and correcting a lot of the problems that we have today in America. So we're going to cover a lot of material tonight. We're going to look at sovereignty and what that is, because what I have discovered is that sovereignty is the key concept around which all political, economic, and legal systems revolve. And we must get a deepening understanding of what sovereignty is in order to embrace the possibilities of rediscovering America, in fact. We're also going to look at citizenship and the distinctions thereof. Now, I'm sure we've had many other speakers here that have addressed these issues, Richard McDonald and the state citizen people. But for those of you who are new, please bear with us. For those who already know, we're going to review these things and the distinctions of citizenship that exist in this country and how it was 220 years ago and how the sovereign citizenship has been encroached over that 220 year period and what historical events happened through the course of our history where today in 1995 we wake up and our sovereignty and our citizenship is a memory, a distant memory in most people's minds, except for those who have recently reclaimed it and are once again drawing that line in the sand and placing a limitation upon the government. We're also going to look at political systems and how they actually work. What really goes on in Washington, D.C.? Who really is directing and controlling the United States government, because it isn't the people that you've elected and it isn't the president, but it's the creditors of the United States that actually direct it. And we're going to look and see how it is that the political system is related to the economic system and from the Federal Reserve Act on up to the present time and the bankruptcies that we've experienced and how bankruptcy affects the political system and the legal system. And then we're going to look at the legal system too and actually how the legal systems operate, what jurisdictions they're operating under, and how we can develop effective strategies to use the courts, to use the administrative processes that we have available to reclaim our rights and defend those rights once we've reclaimed them. So, we're going to begin with sovereignty itself. Sovereignty is the source of authority from which all laws and governments arise. So if you are a sovereign power, and traditionally in the West and in Europe, there were two sources of sovereignty. There were the monarchs, which were the kings and the queens, and there was the Pope and the Catholic Church. And both of those were sources of sovereignty. If you were the sovereign, then your word was the law. It was the same as law. So if you decreed something, it was the same as law. And up until modern times, people, the common people, had no remedy or recourse in relationship to the sovereign. It wasn't until the Magna Carta of 1215 and the Petition of Rights of 1618 in England, and they were the first times that the common people actually had recourse and remedy against the decree of the sovereign. So if you were the sovereign, you created the law. And then out of you, out of the sovereign power, you created nation states and you created governments, you created corporations, you created banks. All of those were created out of the sovereignty itself to serve the sovereignty. And the sovereign powers set up their commercial affairs and their business affairs in trust structures. So the monarch, the king, and the queen of England, for example, set up a sovereign trust out of which the British Empire came. And all the assets and the banks and the nations and parliament were all subject to that trust. And the same is true of many of the other sovereign powers as well. The Roman Catholic Church, the Vatican as the government was created out of the sovereignty of the Pope and the Catholic Church. Now, what's unique here in the United States of America is when this country was settled and founded, many of the people that came over here were settling here to escape from either religious persecution or for political persecution from one of the sovereign powers or one of the governments that were in Europe. And so the people that settled this country did not have high regard for the systems of government or for the traditional sources of sovereignty. And so they were very hesitant to set up a form of government here in the United States of America where they'd have a king, or they would set up a religious leader as the head of state. And so instead of doing that, when they set up this government, they created the sovereign to be the citizen instead of another king. And so built into the American system of law, which begins with the Declaration of Independence, the Articles of Confederation, the American Revolution, which was fought to defend that declaration, and the Treaty of Peace with Great Britain, which was at the conclusion of the American Revolution. That's the foundation of the American system of law, whereby sovereignty is vested in both the citizen and the states. So in order to understand the Constitution, for example, you must understand those instruments first, because the Constitution makes no sense unless you take into consideration that the Constitution was derived from the Declaration of Independence, the Articles of Confederation, and the Treaty of Peace. And so they have to be seen together. But that's where the principles of sovereignty and the principles that were laid out in the Constitution, which set up the United States government and the U.S. corporation, it was created by the Constitution, but from the sovereignty of we the people. We the people are the sovereigns in the Constitutional Republic by law. And we have 220 years of the American system of law. We have a track record that has never been replicated in any other country anywhere else in the world. The United States of America is unique in the world. This is an experiment that was 220 years old. Remember, prior to that, there had never been a time when the common people anywhere were sovereign to anybody. They were all subjects, slaves, serfs, indentured, etc., etc. So our experiment in freedom and liberty for the people began here 220 years ago with the creation of the United States of America. And that's what makes it very difficult for the New World Order to come in here and just simply brush us aside and brush aside our freedoms, because we have it built into our heart and soul. And we are not willing to just brush it aside and become willing slaves again. And that is why they are so afraid of the people. Our government is terrified of us, that we would take responsibility for our lives, that we would actually want to live as free people. And that is part of the polarization that exists here in the country today. And we're going to talk a lot more about how all that works and what we can do about it as well, because we are not helpless in all of this. There is much that we can do, much that we have done, much more that we will do to preserve the liberties that we founded this country on 220 years ago. And I believe that we have enough freedom still kindling in the heart and soul of every American that we can rediscover this country once again and put it back on a constitutional republic. And we can do it in short order. Because... Thank you. So we the people are the sovereigns. We are the sovereign citizens. We are the sovereign people. And the government was set up to serve the sovereign people. So that is the principle that is central to the way our government works and to the way the political, economic, and legal systems work in every country and every power structure around the world today. Central to every war and every conflict that exists in the world today is the issue of sovereignty. Sovereignty is so key and so important that it is blatantly missing from our vocabulary. It is blatantly missing from our education, even our so-called higher education. It is blatantly missing from law school. It is blatantly missing. You don't hear it talked about in the media, except once. Only once did I ever hear the word sovereignty, and it was during the GATT debates on the floor of Congress, for those who were opposed to GATT. And they were saying, but this would compromise the sovereignty of the United States of America, wouldn't it? Yes, it does. Indeed. And so do all the other treaties that we have entered into since around 1945, whereby we have transferred the sovereignty of the United States to internationalist organizations. And so, in order to have a sovereign United States of America, there have to be sovereign citizens and sovereign people in sovereign republics in order for that to occur. That's where it begins, with the people. Now, before I get into citizenship and the distinctions thereof, I'm going to illustrate the power structure a little bit, because it's a mystery to most people how this seemingly very complex structure of control actually works. But it's actually very simple. All power structures are derived from sovereignty itself, all of them. In fact, the sovereignty, you could describe it as the invisible part of the power structure. It's invisible to us. We really don't know who all the sovereigns are on the planet today. They keep themselves invisible and hidden from us. But they are the puppeteers, and they are pulling the strings of the visible part of the power structure, which is the part that we see. We see the nation states, we see the transnational corporations, we see the international bankers, we see the internationalist organizations like the United Nations, the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, the Trilateral Commission, the Council of Foreign Relations. These are all storefronts for the power structure. They're like Hollywood movie sets that all look like they have the power, but if you actually walk in, you'll see that they're really just kind of leaning up on 2x4s. That the power really isn't there either. Wherever the media directs your attention, that's where it ain't happening. If you wonder, why our attention is constantly riveted towards Washington, D.C., and what is Bill Clinton having for lunch today, and when is he getting a haircut, it's because power ain't there. It's somewhere else. And so once you understand that that's how the media distracts us and keeps us from seeing what's true, you have to look in the opposite direction almost to find what's really going on. So instead of focusing all of our attention on the visible part of the power structure, where the attention needs to be is on the puppeteers themselves, who are the sovereign powers that are behind the scenes of all the nation states, behind the scenes of all the transnational corporations, behind the scenes of the international bankers. And there is a lineage of sovereign structures that go back thousands of years. There's an excellent scholarly work by Alexander Christopher called Pandora's Box. Some of you may have seen this. It traces the genealogy of the power structure back 3,000 years up to present time to see actually where these sovereign power structures ended up here in 1995. And it's very surprising to find out that most of the people that are truly the sovereigns and the families that are actually behind it, you've never heard them before. You've never even heard their name. They're invisible. So, my estimate is today, on the planet, there are roughly 40 interlapping power structures in the world today that are the sources of these sovereigns. And they're all fighting with each other and wrestling for larger market share of control over the whole planet and the earth right now, and all of the nation states, economic systems, and legal systems as well. They're not all one big happy family all getting together, you know, and chumming up. They're fighting with each other for control too. There's European power structures, American power structures, South American, Chinese, Japanese, Russian, a lot of power structures competing. And so who will prevail, we don't know. The cards aren't all on the table yet, and the chips aren't all counted yet. But nonetheless, the principle is the important part here. It's behind the scenes is where you have to look to find where power actually exists in the world today. And then, once the people reclaim their sovereignty and their sovereign citizenship, then we know who we're dealing with, because we're dealing on an equal par with those same power structures that are out there manipulating, controlling everybody else who has taken on a subject or a slave status. So, that's about all I'm going to say about sovereignty right now. We're going to keep coming back to it because, in conclusion again, sovereignty is the central concept around which all political, economic, and legal systems revolve. That is the issue. Who is going to be the sovereign? Who is going to prevail? Is it going to be the sovereign powers who are the creditors of this government? Or is it going to be we the people, the sovereigns? Which one are going to prevail? That's the question. We are. We shall prevail because there's no empire in history that has ever been able to squash a free people, ever. Maybe for a little duration or a short period of time, they may put the shackles on for a little while. But most of the shackles they have today are psychological shackles, and they're shackles of information where they keep the information from the people. And once we release those shackles and those chains from ourselves and release ourselves from legal slavery, economic slavery, mental slavery, etc., and we liberate ourselves, then we are unstoppable. So that is my vision and my focus and ours as well for today, and that's where we're going to end up after about 2 hours tonight. And I hope that this will inspire all of us to take the next step to reclaim our sovereignty. So next, I'm going to talk about citizenship and the distinctions thereof, and we're going to review some points in history also, and I hope this will clarify it for people who maybe have just been introduced to this and aren't really clear what a state citizen is versus what is a American national versus what is a sui juris free person. There are some fine line distinctions between these various classifications of free people, and I hope we'll make those clear tonight. Prior to 1868 in this country, there was no such thing as a United States citizen. They did not exist. It wasn't until the 14th Amendment that the U.S. citizen was created as a legal person born or naturalized in the United States. Prior to that, and at the founding of this country, were state citizens. If someone existed as a preamble citizen in the sovereign state of Virginia or New York or Pennsylvania, they considered themselves a Virginia citizen, a New York citizen, a Pennsylvania citizen, etc. They never thought of themselves as United States citizen. Prior to the Civil War and prior to 1868, no one ever referred to themselves as a U.S. citizen. Not even if they resided in the District of Columbia. They still considered themselves citizens of Virginia or New York, etc., etc. So it's a rather new concept, only about 130 so years old. But 220 years ago, firmly founded on those documents of American law that I already mentioned, the sovereignty was vested in the people. And the Treaty of Paris with Great Britain at the conclusion of the American Revolution said quite literally that the people shall have the same prerogative as the king. Now, you don't have to be a genius to figure out what that means. If you're a king or a queen or a sovereign, it means there's no superior authority. There's no one you have to answer to except God and natural law and unalienable rights and all that. The natural law, that you do answer to. But there was no other human government or human being that you answer to as a sovereign or as a sovereign citizen. The American Revolution was fought on, one of the issues was on the issue of land ownership and property ownership. And that at the conclusion of the American Revolution, the American people held the allodial titles to their property. An allodial title is another word for sovereign. If you were a king or a sovereign and you owned a piece of property, you didn't pay taxes to anyone. You didn't have anybody regulate you. There was no building codes. There was no zoning. There was no environmental laws. There was no other encumbrance that could attach to a sovereign property, to an allodial title. An allodial title is superior title. There is no superior title than a land patent. And so when the American Revolution was fought and the sovereign citizens, who were the white male property owners at the time, they then held their property in allodium. They owned it free and clear and outright, and the king, the prior king, could no longer tax them. But neither could the governments that they created, neither the state or the federal governments. So long as property is held in allodium, there is no superior authority. And that's the principle upon which America was founded, so that free people, sovereign people, could live on a sovereign piece of property. Remember the old saying, a king or a queen? You're like a king or a queen in your own home. You've heard the phrase. Well, that's what they meant. They really meant it quite literally. And being a sovereign meant that you had to act like one, a good one. Not a despot, but a good one. And a good sovereign is responsible for themselves and responsible for their family, responsible for their neighbors, and is respectful to their neighbors, and looks out after the greater community. That's what a good sovereign does. So the principle of sovereignty extends to our behaviors, to our values, to our virtues, to good Christian values as well. And so when the country was founded on those principles, and then those principles were embraced by the system of law and the constitutions that were created, both on the state level and the federal level. So, prior to the Constitution, there were sovereign states that were free and independent states, quite literally. That's what it said in the Declaration of Independence and the Articles of Confederation. The states were free and independent, and the people were sovereign within those states. The Constitution was created out of the sovereignty of the people to create this 14th entity originally, the United States Corporation, which served as both a corporate enterprise and a national government. It was carved out of a piece of Virginia and the Virginia Company, in fact. There were two corporations that came here when the country was settled, the New England Corporation in the north and the Virginia Company in the south. And it was out of the Virginia Corporation that the United States Corporation was carved out of. Washington, D.C. was carved out of a prior corporation. It was deeded over and made into a separate jurisdiction in a separate country. So when the Constitution was created, there were then 14 countries here in the United States of America, the 13 colonies and the District of Columbia. And the Constitution, what it did was it put limitations upon that 14th country in relationship to the original 13 colonies and the sovereign people. It basically said, look, we're the sovereign people, okay? And these are the sovereign states. We're going to create, through the Constitution, a corporation and a national government to serve the sovereignty. And you have a very limited authority and limited jurisdiction. And anything that we don't spell out in this Constitution and say that you have the power and authority to do, we're going to reserve it to ourselves through the 9th and 10th Amendments. There's nowhere in the Constitution that says that the federal government has health care or education or agriculture or any of these other areas that they have encroached upon our lives. It doesn't spell it out there. Quite literally, it doesn't say anything about it. And so, when the country was founded, it was for very, very limited jurisdiction. It was meant to be limited. And the Constitution was like a federal employee handbook, instructing the federal government what its job description was, and that it could not go beyond its job description, period. And so, the concept, which is a misconception that most Americans have, is that the Constitution gave you rights. Most people think the Constitution is what gave you rights. That's what they teach in school. They teach you that America started with the Constitution. They barely even talk about the Declaration of Independence anymore. They don't even mention it. They just believe that it started with the government, that the government suddenly is the sovereign power and the people aren't the sovereign power, which isn't true. The Constitution didn't give you any rights. You already had all the rights you could possibly use before the Constitution was created. You had unalienable rights. All the government can possibly give you are civil rights. But what the government can giveth you, the government can taketh away. And so it's not an unalienable right, which is one the government can't give you and can't take away. They're natural law, natural rights, common law. The right to walk, to breathe, to travel, to do commerce. All these derive from the common law. And no government can regulate those. That is a paramount distinction here, very important, between an unalienable right and a civil right. Because a sovereign citizen has unalienable rights, not constitutional rights. The most that a U.S. citizen can have are civil rights, which are rights given by the government. Most people aren't aware that U.S. citizens did not have a right to a trial by jury till 1967. If you're a U.S. citizen, you didn't have a right to a trial by jury till 1967. Well, that's strange. I always thought I had a right to a trial by jury. No, you don't. The sovereign people do. The sovereign people have the unalienable rights under the common law and the Bill of Rights, but the U.S. citizens do not. In fact, the U.S. citizens don't have a Constitution or a Bill of Rights at all. The only ones who have a Constitution and a Bill of Rights are the sovereign citizens. Because again, there's this relationship here. It was the sovereign people that created the Constitution. If there are no sovereign people, there is no Constitution. There is no Bill of Rights. The Bill of Rights is separate from the Constitution. The Constitution is a commercial contract between the states and this corporation. The Bill of Rights was a treaty between the corporation and the sovereign people. If there are no sovereign people, there's no treaty. There's no Bill of Rights. And so all that remains is for most people is to pay lip service to the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. And you hear people taunt them all the time, oh, I've got this, I've got that. But really, there isn't any, by law. And these have been adjudicated in the courts, these distinctions that I'm talking about, who has a Bill of Rights, who doesn't. There are different rights and immunities for a sovereign citizen versus a U.S. citizen. So when was a U.S. citizen created? The U.S. citizen was created by the 14th Amendment in 1868, one of the Reconstruction Amendments after the Civil War. Now, the Civil War was a pivotal point in American history. And most people believe today, as they're teaching, that Abraham Lincoln, the great emancipator and all that, it was all about freeing the slaves. That is what we are taught. And although the slaves were freed at the conclusion of the Civil War, it was not from some great ideological or moral purpose that they were freed. It was more of an economic sanction to cripple the South than it was some great moral and ethical purpose. The real purpose for the Civil War, the reason it was fought, was over the issue of state sovereignty. That's why the Civil War was fought. It was fought because the South, who had not fared well under this constitutional contract and the federal government that happened to be in place and the European powers that were influencing the federal government and the industrial North, were preferential to the industries and the commerce of the North and deferential to the South. And so the South said, hey, we're getting the bad end of the deal here. We want to secede from this union. We want to revoke this contract that we created. The states created the Constitution, remember. They wanted to revoke the contract and secede from the union because it wasn't serving them any longer. And then the federal government and the European powers behind that in the North, of course, crushed the state sovereignty and the secession movement of the South. That was why the Civil War was fought. And from that point to the present time, there has been a continual assault upon the sovereignty of the states and the sovereignty of the citizens. And as time has progressed, more and more and more of the sovereign people have become U.S. citizens. More and more of the responsibilities of the states have been transferred to the federal United States, to that little area, that District of Columbia, that 14th country that was created, that only had jurisdiction within the 63 square miles of the District of Columbia or an unincorporated territory or any area that it had a federal area or a federal enclave, any place there existed United States citizens, in fact. So the Constitution did not give you rights. You had rights prior to the Constitution. It simply restated what rights, the unalienable rights that the sovereign people had. The Constitution was a contract between the states and this new corporation, the United States Corporation. And so, from the point of the Civil War to the point of the Federal Reserve Act of 1913, which I'll talk about when I get into the economic section, there was a long duration of time between that and the Social Security Act. When the 14th Amendment was passed, it was passed for the newly freed black slaves. Because the country was racially divided during the Civil War, prior to the Civil War, and since the Civil War, around the issue of whether or not blacks were going to be given full sovereign rights. Citizenship was determined by the states, not by the federal government. Every state had and still has the power to naturalize citizens directly through the superior courts. Ex parte Frank Knowles here is the Supreme Court precedent for that. And in the state constitutions, it delineated what a citizen was. A citizen was a white male, basically, in most of the states. And so there were great debates about whether or not the newly freed black slaves were going to be given the unalienable rights of the sovereign people, or whether they were even going to be given freeman status within the states. And because most of the states were unwilling to do that, all of them but two, New York and Pennsylvania were both willing to grant the newly freed black slaves full sovereign status. The federal government and the European powers behind it saw this as an opportunity to wrestle the sovereignty away from the states and the citizens, and saw the 14th Amendment as an opportunity to begin the long road of encroachment and thus granted United States citizenship to the newly freed black slaves and granted them civil rights and protection of the federal government. But again, they got civil rights, not unalienable rights. They know they got a bad deal. They didn't get the unalienable rights, they just got civil rights. There were two parts of the 14th Amendment. The first part was a person is a legal fiction. A U.S. citizen is a legal fiction like a corporation or a trust is. It's just created. It doesn't represent, it doesn't mean an actual live individual human being. That's not the person that they're talking about in the 14th Amendment. But they created a U.S. citizen, a fictitious citizen. The U.S. citizen isn't a citizen at all, because a corporation can't have citizens. A corporation can only have franchisees. That's why they call it the Franchise Tax Board here in California, because if you're a U.S. citizen or a resident, you're a franchisee of the state of California corporation, and thus you're subject to the income tax, and you have to give back to the corporation that gave you something. And what the newly freed black slaves and U.S. citizens had to give back in order to get protection and so-called benefits from the federal government was they had to give up their unalienable rights. In fact, they had to become property of the federal government. The birth certificate was created for the children of the newly freed black slaves. Anybody here got a birth certificate still? You're a black slave. They were created for the black slaves. It enrolled the black slaves' children as property of the federal United States. When you get a birth certificate, you become property of the federal United States. Your birth certificate is transferred to the Bureau of Census, to the Department of Commerce. You are enrolled as a beneficiary of the Federal Reserve System, and you become obligated to the national and federal debts. That's one of the foundational instruments, one of the adhesion contracts, we call them. And so, from the point of the 14th Amendment, the second part of the 14th Amendment, which people aren't aware of, is that it says that no citizen shall question the debt, which established the precedent whereby if you became a U.S. citizen, you no longer could question the federal government's spending. You just became obligated, carte blanche, to whatever shopping spree the federal government was up to. And so from the 14th Amendment on through till about 1933 after the Great Depression, that's when most white Americans began to transfer their citizenship over to the federal United States. After 3 or 4 years of the hardships of the Great Depression, people were very demoralized. And so when they enrolled in the Social Security system to get a benefit from the government, unknown to them in the SS-5, is that when they asked the simple little question on the form, are you a U.S. citizen, and you check the box, you just gave up your unalienable rights, you gave up your sovereign citizenship, you gave up your Constitution, you gave up your Bill of Rights, and you gave up your country. All because you didn't know there was a distinction between a sovereign state citizen and a U.S. citizen. And so when you got a Social Security number, that was the beginning of a long road of giving up and waiving your rights and become a subject of the federal government. Driver's licenses, vehicle registrations, marriage licenses, incorporation papers, business licenses are all adhesion contracts. And in each one of those, you give up another piece of your rights. And in the end, you have nothing. You have no rights, not even to control what you do with your body. They want to tell you what to do with your body. Jimmy Carter transferred all the birth certificates as collateral against the national debt to the international bankers when he was president. They took your birth certificate as a security and a trust instrument that it is and gave it to the international bankers as collateral so they could borrow more money. So your labor, your effort, your work, all of your life will never belong to you. And so these are the paramount distinctions of citizenship between the sovereign state citizen and the United States citizen. The United States citizen is a legal fiction, a subject of a corporation, subject to all the laws and rules and regulations and acts of Congresses and executive orders, and to the debt. However unpayable it is, you're subject to it. It's an unpayable debt. can't be paid. All the lip service about balancing the budget, it cannot be paid. It is unsustainable. There was never any provision in the Federal Reserve Act for ever paying the principal. Ever. It was a very well-conceived plan to not only take the sovereignty from the people, but to take all their property as well. And we consented. We consented because we didn't know, because we were ignorant, maybe we were afraid, maybe we were distracted, maybe we weren't paying attention, maybe we weren't being ever vigilant, maybe we weren't watching. And so, now that we know what has occurred, we can now take steps to remedy that. We can take steps to reclaim our sovereign citizenship. There are a lot of things that you can do. Now, I don't expect everybody to run out here tomorrow and go file your affidavits and burn your driver's license and all that stuff. There's probably a number of people here who have already done that. But maybe for those of you who are new to some of this, maybe it'll be the first step on a road and a path back to freedom and back to sovereignty and back to restoring the constitutional republic that we have. Because we don't have a constitutional republic unless they're sovereign citizens. You don't have Second Amendment rights to bear arms unless you're a sovereign citizen. Because there is no Second Amendment unless you're a sovereign citizen by law. None of the amendments apply unless you're a sovereign citizen. Now, whether you become a sovereign state citizen of a particular state, the state citizenship movement is about picking and choosing one of the several states and working within the legal structure of that state in which provisions are there to recognize the common law citizens of California or Oregon. Even in the Motor Vehicle Code, Section 290, the common law, the property of common law citizens are exempt from the Motor Vehicle Code. They had to build in these distinctions in the law. The things I'm talking about tonight are not the rantings and ravings of some crazy conspiracy theory. But these are all in the public record. It's in the law. They're in the United States codes. They're in the California codes. They're in the congressional records. They're in the treaties. They're there to be seen. It's just that not too many people actually read those things, and they don't make it real easy to find. And so unless you enjoy doing that kind of research and poring over the old law books, you might not find these things. But fortunately, there are a lot of people out there who enjoy doing that and have enjoyed it for quite some time. And now we've pulled together a lot of the research of most of those people. I put it together in a book called Reclaiming Your Sovereign Citizenship, so you can have it all between pages of about 250 pages, so you don't have to spend the next 40 years doing the research. You could probably read it all in 2 days, and at least get enough background so that you can begin to walk on that path of sovereignty without reinventing the wheel. So we need to reclaim our sovereign citizenship in order to get our country back. And the state citizenship movement is one of the approaches where you choose one of the states. There's also a classification, I'll call it, called the American National. Now, an American National is one who has not chosen any of the several states in particular, but is in fact a non-resident alien, American National. On the USA passport applications, you will notice on the back that the USA passport is for both American nationals and United States citizens. The American national is the non-resident alien or the state citizen or the American national, the free sovereign person, people that they're talking about. And you don't need a Social Security number to get a passport. You don't even need a birth certificate if you have other hospital certifications or affidavits of live birth in lieu of your birth certificate. You can still get a USA passport, which is a legitimate function of the national government still. It's a United States of America passport, not a federal United States passport. So from the Social Security Act on up to present time, people have, through many, many adhesion contracts, given up their sovereign citizenship and become U.S. citizens. And in order to reclaim your sovereign citizenship, the first thing that you need to do is to revoke all the contracts you've entered into with the government whereby you have revoked your rights, your citizenship, etc. And that's why I say not everybody's going to run out of here tomorrow and do it, because you may have to rearrange your affairs a little bit. You may have to do things a little differently. You may have to do business a little bit differently. Now, you'll be able to do business. You'll be able to do everything you can do now, only do it as a free person instead, and a person who has the sovereign powers of a sovereign citizen. But it may take a little time getting adjusted to it and getting used to it. So take your time. Take the time that it takes to study and to learn for yourself and to choose for yourself. And then be prepared to defend those rights once you've reclaimed them. Because the government isn't all that willing to see the sovereignty be restored to the people at this point. They're all too happy right now to be the masters. But somebody's got to step forward and draw the line in the sand and tell the government to go back to the limited authority and jurisdiction that the Constitution laid out for you. And quite frankly, the more the merrier. If there's only one person on that line, it's going to be a lot harder to hold the line back than if there's 10 million people on that line. And right now, there are anywhere between 500,000 and 1 million people reclaiming their sovereignty in this country, and they are afraid to death of that. And because we live in the communications revolution, you cannot keep it a secret any longer. Because we are all internetworked, and we're surfing the internet, and we're videoing, and we're autoing, and we're publishing books, and we're telling each other. You cannot suppress the truth. You cannot do it. They cannot succeed, though they will try. And they will pass counterterrorism bills, and they'll pass bills till they're blue in the face. But those don't apply to me. The executive orders don't apply to me. Acts of Congress don't apply to me. Unless they're prefixed with an H. If it's prefixed with an H, then they're wearing the hat of the national government. If it's prefixed with an HR, it's for the corporation, which is only for the US citizens. That's the distinction between when your senators and your congressmen are wearing the hat of the national government or wearing the hat of the federal corporation. When they went bankrupt in 1933, they went bankrupt for all the US citizens, not the sovereign citizens. But unfortunately, the sovereign citizens turned in their gold just like everybody else and figured, well, this is the patriotic thing to do. They believed that at that time because they didn't know any better. So if you want the government to go away, make them obsolete. And restore the institutions that we do have available, the jural societies, the constitutional republics, those things we have. We have the American system of law right here at our disposal. It's there. They haven't revoked it. They haven't repealed it. They haven't even deleted the sections that they ought to be deleting. But there's too many law books out there, and it'd be pretty hard to rip out all the pages that were pertinent to us. Plus, it's all available on CD-ROM as well. So, don't be afraid to use these tools that we have available here, because this is what we've got going for us. In the last 3 years, I have watched rooms of people where nobody knew what the heck I was talking about. They had never heard any of it before, to rooms full of people that have heard bits and pieces of it, and lots of people who've heard a lot about it, and a lot of people who are taking a lot of action about it. And that's only in the course of a couple years that that has happened. I think perhaps for the first time in history that all the pieces of the puzzle are there. We can see the whole thing transparently now. And by the end of this evening, I hope you'll all see it as transparently as I do, and how all these different things relate. The sovereignty, the citizenship, and now we're going to talk about politics, economics, and law, and you're going to see how all those systems relate. And then you're going to see transparently that they only have one agenda. There's only one agenda. It's very simple. They just want to control the world. It's very simple. And they're using every means at their disposal. Political means, economic means, legal means, military means, police means, media, propaganda, deception, distraction, demoralization, terrorism, whatever. And so we have to be better prepared, better educated, develop better strategies than they do. And that's what will make the difference, strategic planning, from a citizen's point of view, and use all the tools that we have available to communicate it broadly, because the cat's out of the bag, and there's no way they're going to stuff it back in the bag again. There aren't enough concentration camps in this country to suppress it. There are not enough military forces on this entire planet to suppress this country. Just look at how much firepower was directed at Iraq. All of the Western power structures directed their mighty firepower on this one small little country. That was it. That was the big show. That's all they've got to show. This country is far too decentralized, far too rural, far too independent. They could never take it by military means. The only way they can take it is by psychological warfare and psychological means, where they convince you that you're slaves and you volunteer into it and you consent to it. And that has been their strategy from day one, because they knew they could never invade this country militarily and succeed. There's too many people that have guns still. And even in their own... And even in their own Gallup poll, which I was surprised at, and Gallup had polled the people here during in the aftermath, in the wake of the Oklahoma City bombings, that there were 70 million Americans that were willing to take up arms against their government, if necessary, to defend their rights. That's pretty amazing. Now, I'm not an advocate of violence, and I'm not an advocate of war as the first resort. I'm an advocate of using all the other tools we have available, including the legal system and the communication system and the community systems that we have available. That's our first line of defense and offense in all of this. That we might even win this thing without firing a single shot if we develop the strategies that can work in the midst of that. That would be a great revolution. As we all know, in the wake of the Oklahoma City bombing, there's been a lot of talking about and raising of some of the issues and slanting and distorting of the issues as well. But there is an opportunity here for a forum that didn't exist before. And I commiserate with the tragedy for the victims of the bombing and all the possible scenarios of who done it and how it actually happened, and whether it was an extremist faction of the militia, which I doubt very seriously, whether the federal government bombed it, whether the Japanese bombed it. There are all kinds of different scenarios here that have been postulated with various affidavits and evidence to support various points of view. And I'm not at the point where I'm going to make a conclusion about any of that. I'm going to reserve judgment for a while until there's a few more chips in a row. But it's very interesting to watch the media spin and to watch also our reaction too. And I suggest that we be considerate in what we take on as fact and what we take on as speculation with regards to it all. Because it doesn't help our cause to speculate falsely and to spread false rumors about things that we really don't have substantial evidence for. Let's wait to see all the evidence, and then we'll bring forth the appropriate indictments. But until that time, it's better to reserve judgment. So, who really holds the power in Washington, D.C.? How do the political systems actually work? It's really very simple. The federal United States is a corporation and a national government both. When the federal government went bankrupt for the first time in 1930, which may be news to some people, but to others, it's not news. But the government has been bankrupt 7 times in this century. And every time the federal government goes bankrupt, it has to reorganize. It has to raise the debt ceiling and go begging to the Federal Reserve to borrow some more money to keep the doors of the power structure open a little longer. Otherwise, Congress would be on an indefinite vacation, which might be a good idea. I would pay for a vacation. A permanent vacation for all of Congress for 5 years or so, and then maybe we could reinvent this thing, actually reinvent it, not not Bill Clinton's reinventing government plan, but really reinvent it from the citizens' point of view this time, from the sovereign, we the people point of view once again. Who really directs the federal United States are the creditors. This is no great mystery to those who understand the law. Now, if you are a bankrupt company, corporation, or individual, who directs your affairs? Your creditors do. A bankrupt entity no longer has the legal power or authority to direct its own affairs. Every time the federal government went bankrupt, it had to transfer its authority over to its creditors in order to reorganize the assets to resolve the bankruptcy to the satisfaction of the creditors. Otherwise, they would go on permanent vacation. And so it's very easy to see why the elected representatives and the president and all the agencies of government are so beholden to the creditors of the federal United States, who actually direct the government. The secret government that we talk about is, yes, there is a secret government, and there's FEMA, and there's people impersonating presidents. But more than that, it's behind the power structure. The invisible power structure here is pulling the strings of the creditors, who are, in fact, then directing the United States federal government. If you wonder why NAFTA and GATT were passed with so little debate, it's because it was all smoke and whistles. It had already been decided by those who direct the government that these are the bills that are going to be passed, including the counterterrorism bill and everything that Congress does, except maybe making some ridiculous joint resolution about making something a national holiday for parakeets or something. That, you know, they may have some power, but not a lot. The real significant bills and the real significant budgets are directed lock, stock, and barrel by the creditors. We either fund them or we don't fund them. It's as simple as that. If you wonder why they're building prisons instead of schools and they had to cut the lunch program, it's because that's the agenda of the creditors of the federal United States. We can afford to build prisons, no problem. We can afford to put 100,000 new revenue agents out on the street, call them police, but what we're really doing is trying to raise some more revenue to keep the government open. We can afford to put a rapid strike force out there. We can afford to bring in 500,000 United Nations troops and build all these concentration camps. But we can't afford money for education. We can't afford money for school lunches or anything else that's really important. So be very clear that it's the creditors of the federal United States, which is the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, and the sovereign powers behind that are the creditors who are directing it. All of the nation states of the United Nations are bankrupt. It's one of the conditions of membership, by the way, of the United Nations. You have to be a bankrupt country. Otherwise, you can't be subject to being controlled. Now, can you? When you become bankrupt, you transfer your sovereignty, because you stole it from the people, right? You stole your sovereignty from the people in the states, and now you basically hand it over to the creditors to direct the affairs of the nation and the spending policies, et cetera, et cetera. So how did all this happen? Well, we'll have to talk a little bit of economics in order to see how this historically happened. Now, as you probably know from reading your Constitution, that Congress has the authority to coin money, which is gold or silver, and that's what a constitutional money system comprises. The Founding Fathers were pretty smart about a number of things, and that was one thing. They knew that as soon as they issued paper money substitutes or created a national banking system, it wouldn't be very long before the international bankers were controlling not only the government but the economic system. And so that's why they put us on a gold standard and made it a constitutional standard. When the Constitution was first created, it was created as an ultra-sovereign canon law trust. All governments, nation states, and sovereign powers operate within trust structures, all of them. We can also operate in trust structures, and we'll talk about trusts in a little bit. But the original ultra-sovereign canon law trust was merged from both the common law of the Constitution and England, but also the canon laws from the Pope, when the ultra-sovereign canon law trust was created in 1776. And we, the people, were the trustees of that trust up until 1913. In 1913, the Federal Reserve Act created a joint stock trust that replaced the ultra-sovereign canon law trust and made we, the international bankers, as the trustees of that trust, and assigned the U.S. citizens as beneficiaries of the trust. The trust structure that existed in 1776 was replaced with another one. That's called the coup d'etat.
under law. It was done by law. It was done legally, okay? All of this usurpation has happened legally. Not lawfully, legally. And so the status of we the people was reversed from the top at the helm to the bottom, which is getting the handouts, basically. Free lunches, food stamps, welfare, whatever, civil rights, whatever we want to hand you guys. Now, it all seems like a great idea to be the beneficiary of a trust, doesn't it? It's not like, wow, I'm going to really cash in, aren't I? Being the beneficiary of a trust. Well, unfortunately, the only thing you're going to cash in on is an obligation to pay the debt. Prior to 1913, the American people had direct veto power against spending policies of the federal government, because in order for the federal government to borrow any money, it had to go to the people. There was no central bank it could go to. It had to sell bonds. If you didn't want to go to war, you didn't buy the bonds. If you didn't want this pork project that the government had in mind, you didn't buy the bonds. It was a very simple system, a Republican system whereby you had veto power, economic veto power. And it worked very well until 1913. That's how come government managed to stay small, because it didn't have an unlimited credit line to go on a shopping spree for 80 years and make you pay for it. So in 1913, there was this convenient new arrangement made. The Federal Reserve Act created an unlimited credit line for the federal United States government to borrow directly from the Federal Reserve Bank and obligated the American people to pay it back, completely bypassing what was our veto power, and they no longer had to come to us directly to ask permission to fund something. They went directly to the bank. Now, if you go to the bank and want to borrow some money, what do you got to do? You got to put collateral up, right? They're not going to give you a $5,000 loan if you have no collateral, if it's unsecured. You're going to have to put up your house, your car, or your land, or something, right? Well, it's no different for the government, except the government doesn't have any assets. That's the difference. And so, instead of putting up the assets they didn't have, they put up your assets. They said, here, we'll make you a deal. You lend us all the money, and we're going to collateralize first the gold, and then the land, and then the corporations, then the national parks and forests, then the birth certificates, until we've collateralized all the tangible property in the United States of America. The first thing they collateralized against the debt in 1913 was the gold. It's called hypothecate. It's a legal term, means that, theoretically, if you can't pay it off, hardy har har, we're going to take the collateral, which they did in 1933. It only took 17 years under this new arrangement for the federal United States to go bankrupt the first time. Only 17 years before they couldn't service the debt, the interest on the debt of the money that they had borrowed. And so they had to declare bankruptcy in the Bretton Woods Agreement in 1930, 16 nations went bankrupt after World War I. And this was one of them, the United States, federal United States. And so when the country went bankrupt, it precipitated the Great Depression, which was also manipulated and created by the international bankers to demoralize the people, number one, but also to shift power away from the sovereign people, and shift the land away, and to shift the gold away from the people and into the hands of the international bankers and the sovereign power structures behind them. So in 1933, with House Joint Resolution 192, on the floor of Congress, the federal United States declared bankruptcy and no longer could service debt with gold because it had no more. And so it then made what we call now legal tender, or fiat money, a money paper substitute, and then decreed that, well, since we don't have any gold, you know, we'll just have to use paper instead. And then they passed the Gold Standard Act in 1935 and confiscated all the gold from the American people to satisfy the creditors of the United States. And the people willingly handed all their gold over to the nearest Federal Reserve Bank and initially got a paper currency that was redeemable in gold or silver at a revaluation from 1/20th of an ounce to 1/35th of an ounce. But shortly thereafter, within a matter of a couple years, you no longer could redeem it. So you basically traded gold for paper. What a great deal. That was the first bankruptcy. And ever since that point, we have been proceeding down the road of an exponential debt curve whereby there is only one possible conclusion of an economic system set up on an unsound and unsustainable basis, which is bankruptcy. Not just for the government, but for all the people as well. And so the federal government went bankrupt, and every time it's gone bankrupt, it's transferred more of the assets of the American people over to the international bankers. And because the American people are not aware of the nature of ownership, the nature of titles, the nature of sovereignty itself, we allow that to happen. A deed is not title. You do not have title if you have a deed. You can pay your mortgage for 30 years, and you will not own your property. You only have a deed. A deed is not a title. A title is the land patent. It's called an allodial title. You lost the allodial title the minute you collateralized your land and borrowed money and put up your land as security against it. It's a condition of every bank contract that the allodial title reverts to the federal government as a condition of every bank contract and mortgage in this country. But you didn't know that. Go ask the title insurance companies. They know, but they won't tell you. They scream at me and hang up the phone every time I call them and ask them, please tell me about allodial titles. Don't you ever call me again. Because they're engaged in monumental fraud, that's why. Because they've deceived you out of your title. You can get it back by updating your land patent. One of the supplemental books that I offer is on allodial titles and land patents. And there is a process there where you can declare your land patent and rewrite the legal description of the original land patent, file it with the county recorder's office, and it'll put one more line of resistance between you and any foreclosure. It's not absolutely 100% guaranteed because the government doesn't obey the law. Okay, they just make them. So sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. But the only way they will, ultimately, is if we practice it. If we want to reapply the American system of law, we've got to use it. We've got to dust it off. It just needs to be used. Every day, everywhere you are, everywhere you go, and with every government person you come into contact with, you've got to remind them who you are. I'm not just this, you know, schmuck here in line waiting to sign your form. I am your employer. I am the sovereign people out of which you got your job, and you are subject to the law as well as I am. And make sure you remember that, to tell them that. There is no government immunity in the constitutional republic that we will rediscover in this country. They will be held to the same standard, if not a higher standard of performance than we are, because they are our supposed representatives, and they better well uphold the law. So the allodial title is one way to protect your land. There are other ways, of course, through trust structures and other means. If you have assets, property, multiple properties, rental properties, then an allodial title may not be satisfactory or sufficient. You may need to organize your affairs in a business trust or some other complex trust structure. Common law trusts or offshore, there's a number of options. There's at least 145 different types of trusts. But you've got to think trust, and you've got to think of having the legal protection, the same types of legal protections that the power structure has enjoyed for thousands of years, that you just are beginning to be aware of, that if you want to hold on to the little piece that you have, that you're going to have to start thinking in these terms. Otherwise, someday, the piper will be at the door, and they're going to take away what you have, and you won't have any recourse at that point. It'll be more difficult, let's put it that way. So every time the federal government has gone bankrupt, it's transferred more of the assets. In 1995, the international bankers own it all. There isn't any land in this country. There's no national parks and forests. There's no birth certificates, no corporations that are not owned lock, stock, and barrel by the international bankers. The titles, okay, are owned. They've been transferred as collateral to the international bankers, these stocks and bonds and securities and all that. So let's talk a little bit about the nature of the currency system, because this will help to clarify why it is that we're going bankrupt. And we are bankrupt. It's because of the nature of the currency itself. This is not a constitutional money. This is only paper, by the way. It's just paper. And it is created by the banks out of thin air. When you write a check and there's no money in the bank, you get a bounce check fee. When the banks write a check and there's no money in the bank, they call it a loan. That's the difference between us and the banks, okay? And so, there's roughly $7 trillion of electronic money floating around out there right now. Electronic deposit accounting ledger pieces, that's all these are. This is only for accounting purposes only. This isn't money. It's not an asset. It's a debt. It is only a convenient way of depositing or writing negotiable instruments on these electronic, fictitious, paper money systems.
What's the evidence you don't think it's money?
What's that?
If you don't think it's money, what's the evidence?
Here, you can have it.
They won't give it to me.
Sure, I will.
A whole box of them? Now you're getting greedy.
That's right. Now let's watch your greed here. It has buying power, maybe, temporarily. But it has a fluctuating buying power depending on its value. And its value is determined by the international bankers, depending on the interest rates, the velocity of the currency, the strength of the economy, the productivity of the people, its relationship to other currencies and other economies.
That was a mouthful.
Well, I'm trying to make a very long story short, so, and I only have a limited amount of time. Every dollar in circulation, of which there's right now 1 trillion FRNs in circulation, 1 trillion of them, there's $7 trillion in electronic money, 1 trillion in the actual currency, of which 650 billion are offshore, and there's only 350 billion FRNs in circulation within the United States of America. Divide that by the population, and you'll understand why people are constrained, why the economy is contracted, because the money supply is contracted. There isn't a lot of money supply. But more importantly than money supply is the velocity of money. That is really the key factor. It's not so much that there's only 350 billion of these, but how fast do these exchange hands? You could stimulate an economy in this room very quickly if you were all willing to offer goods and services to each other for 20 bucks. And just watch the velocity create an economic system. But as long as we are holding on to it like this, scared to let it go because it's my last one, and I've got to pay my rent and I've got to do all this stuff, economies stifle when there's no velocity. There's no velocity because there's no trust, there's no community, there's no community organization, and also we don't understand the nature of it. When you understand the nature of it, that this is only a tool to create an economy, unfortunately, this tool creates an economy that transfers all the wealth from the people to the hands of a small few who pull the strings of this New World Order. And so you've got to understand the nature of money, because we are so psychologically off base with regards to it. We have a lot of addictions around it. We make a lot of decisions in our lives based on we have it or we don't. And we neglect things that we need in our lives sometimes. Something we need for our health, something that we need for our children, something we need to eat even, because we don't have these. We suffer a lot because of what we think this is. And there are alternatives. Every one of these that are in circulation incurs a debt. The federal debt isn't just what the federal government spends in excess of revenues, but every dollar in your pocket sitting there right now, idle in your pocket, is accruing a debt that can never be paid off, which is the end of a long cycle of shifting all the sovereignty and the property of the American people over to the international bankers. And we barely noticed. That's how sublime and so clever and so gradual it was. We didn't notice that it happened until recently. We just started noticing again. So every dollar in circulation, all that $1 trillion in circulation is incurring a debt right now, and interest at the prime rate. Every dollar in circulation, which can never be paid off. I'll give you a few examples of a few ways that the banking system makes money. The U.S. Treasury still prints these at 3 cents a piece for a $100 bill. The Federal Reserve Bank buys it for 3 cents, then loans it back to the federal government for $100 plus interest. Pretty handsome profit, wouldn't you say? $99.97 profit on every $100 bill in circulation plus interest. Well, if I had a scam going like that, it wouldn't take very long for me to have all of your property either, or anybody else who had a scam going like that. It wouldn't take very long until you had everything. Now, would it? That's only one way that the banks make money. The other way that they make money is through the fractional reserve banking system, which is that when you deposit a $100 bill in a bank, the bank only has to keep a certain percentage of that on reserve. It used to be 20%. Then it was 10%. And now it's like 3% right now. So, which that means if you deposit a $100 bill in the bank only has to keep $3 in the drawer in case you come back for it. The other $97, it instantly loans out at prevailing rates of interest and speculates on derivatives and speculates on real estate and buys all kinds of things. That's pretty good leverage, wouldn't you say? I think we should all create our own bank.
Yes.
I think we need to create our own bank. First, you set up a community trust structure, and then you appoint everybody as a managing director of a trust. You set up a trust account for everybody. Everybody pools all this together. You buy gold and silver with it. You invest it, and you pay dividends back to everybody in the community. That's how we could run an economic system and completely bypass the federal government and the international bankers. Every community could do that. Every church could do that. Every organization could do that. Every family could do that. And watch the wealth start shifting back into your hands again instead of into the hands of those who really don't care about your wealth. The New World Order has no concern for your money, really. They just want power and control. That's all they want. Because they're scared and insecure. So that's the nature of economics. It is debt-oriented. The only possible result is an exponential debt curve, which if you look at the graphs right now, that the graph of the late 90s is like going like that right now. The 16 central banks of Europe, as of May 1994, will no longer buy long-term treasury notes or government bonds. The only thing that has kept our standard of living afloat for the last 40 years is because the dollar has been artificially floated by the central banks of Europe because they wanted to maintain the productivity of the American people until, one, they confiscated all the property, and number two, they'd installed the police state to police the residue and the social disintegration that would result once the bankruptcy was finally declared. That is the only political agenda, that's the only economic agenda, and it's the only legal agenda at this point. To make a very complex story very simple, bankruptcy is the key word. And that's why the courts are as busy as they are, and the police are as busy as they are, writing traffic citations, and the IRS is busy seizing property, and they're seizing property for drug forfeitures, and forfeituring property of all kinds. Man, go to the government auctions, they're great. You hear them advertise all the time. Brand new cars, no minimum bid. All these government forfeitures and seizures, they have so much property they've confiscated from the American people, they don't even know how to get rid of it. They can't even warehouse it. There's a warehouse up in Portland that has like 5,000 vehicles in it. They can't even get rid of the stuff. But it's really all they're doing is they're shuffling the titles around, the securities. They're trying to keep the doors of government open at every level. And since they passed the impounding codes here recently in California, and I know because I've had my vehicle impounded twice in 2 days when I came down my last trip, I have the inside scoop on dealing with impounds here. Welcome to California. I was within 5 miles of the border, I was impounded. Welcome to California. Well, because I'm one of those nutcases that was driving around without license plates or without driver's licenses, and I had flags waving out the back of my window saying, come and get me.
How'd you get your car back?
There's nothing a little bit of paper won't do to solve your problems, to get you back on the road again. But in the meanwhile, I have plenty of grist for the mill in my right to travel cases in Oregon and California, and the Title 42 lawsuits that are forthcoming, and the administrative procedures which we are perfecting, and the Admiralty Cross claims, and the maritime procedures that we're developing in the court systems are all so that we can basically draw the line in the sand again and try to reestablish what was once our right to travel. That was, but see, your minds are working great. You see, you didn't skip a beat. You went right through. You got the whole thing, right?
I did
not. I could go off on a lot of tangents, and I try to hold to my subject here. Otherwise, we'll be talking about my right to travel case and jail and all that stuff, which isn't as much fun to talk about as the stuff we're talking about now. So,
come back again.
I'll come back again and we'll talk about those things. I was talking about the impounding, and the reason that they have the impounding laws here, the reason they've passed them and are aggressively enforcing them, is because the governments are desperate for revenue. And it depends on the county. It really varies. Up in Palo Alto, where there's lots of wealthy people, and you know, and they really don't need to extract revenue from the parking meters, like they really could care about the quarter, you know? And so they don't enforce as aggressively in a Palo Alto as they do in Oakland, where in Oakland, they're out on the streets 24 hours a day. They've got police cars patrolling every street with a tow truck behind them. They're checking on every license plate as they drive down the street. And if you've got an outstanding parking ticket, they steal your car on the spot. So it depends on where you live, partly, and how desperate your local government is as to how much they want to enforce these things. There's a whole lot of variance here with right to travel cases. Some people actually get to travel around in their counties without too much harassment. They may know the county sheriff a little better than I do, but other people are attacked all the time for doing those things. So if you take on those issues, I say go for it. But not everybody has to be out there dealing with the right to travel issue. I'm not suggesting everybody go out there and take all the plates off your cars tomorrow and all go get arrested and get impounded and all that. There's other ways of dealing with it. If you can still become a sovereign citizen, and what I have done on this trip, I bought another car, and I have registered it in a trust. So I am no longer, don't have this property. My trust has this property, so I don't have the flags flying out the back window on this trip, so I could actually get here tonight and to make all the other 7 seminars I had scheduled down here. Because that's a bit of a hassle when you can't get where you're going. So there's more important things sometimes. But that's the underlying agenda behind a lot of these aggressive laws and a lot of the police on the streets and all that. And so having that information is real important because it's a piece of the communications that we have to have with our government, with our local governments and with the police officers. I've had incredible conversations with police officers, even while I'm sitting in the back of the patrol car in handcuffs, having these incredible constitutional conversations with them. And it's just wonderful. Of course, I've also heard a few deriding comments like, you know, there's about 4 or 5 police over here and they're going, is that one of those constitutionalists over there? That's what they call me. I said, why do you call me a constitutionalist with a degrading tone of voice? Didn't you also uphold an oath of allegiance to the Constitution? Do you have a different Constitution than I do? If so, I'd like to see it. There's only one Constitution, so how is it that a constitutionalist is a degrading, insulting term? How come Janet Reno gets on TV and says them constitutionalists, those sovereign citizens, those state citizens, those militia people are all domestic terrorists, and they're all white supremacists, and they're all racists, da-da-da-da-da. I don't want to be all thrown in that big pot, you see. Not that it's not good company. It's just that I think we need to make some clear distinctions here. That, yeah, this isn't, you know, a recruiting group for the militia. This is a forum where people can freely express what's on their minds. I mean, after all, freedom of speech and all that. And regardless of whatever your point of view might be, regardless of what your politics may be, whether it's left or right, I happen to presently believe that left or right is irrelevant. That it makes no difference. And we've got to stop pointing fingers at liberals or conservatives or Republicans or Democrats, and all that is a distraction that keeps the American people divided from the real issues and the real ones who are trying to take over here. And I find that to be a healthy sign that in the lectures and in the workshops that I do, that it is not a homogenous group. That there are all kinds of Americans coming to these groups. And people who genuinely disagree with each other. And that's fine. How else are you going to learn anything unless you dialogue with somebody who you don't agree with? But you can have a healthy communications if you have a healthy listening and the ability to listen to someone else. You might really learn something. That everybody has a piece of the truth. Everybody knows a little bit of it. And our job is to put it all together so we can make sense of it and that we can go forward. So that's about all I need to say about the economic system. We've looked at the political system. We know that it's linked into the bankruptcy. We know the foreign powers are directing it and the creditors of the federal United States. The economic system is a debt-oriented system. It is bankrupt financially, morally, and politically. We need to reinvent another economic system, and you can do that. We've done that up in the Northwest and a number of other places. There's a little book back there called The Cascadia Hour. We actually created our own money system, you see. We figured, well, if these are short and everybody's kind of clawing around trying to get enough of them, we'd create our own money system, which is what we did. We created what we call the Cascadia Hour. We just paid some paper up just like the Federal Reserve did. Only this time we call it a Cascadia Hour, which has a $10 equivalency, and we can use this within our community to buy goods and services as supplemental to this. It doesn't completely replace this, because yeah, some things, you know, I can't go to the gas station and take those right now, but there's other things in the community that people do take. And all we had to do is print some currency. We granted it into circulation 5 hours per person, and they like paid like $5 or $10 into this little fund. Then we printed up a directory of all the people that were willing to accept and spend it. And then you could go shopping in the directory and use this instead of this. And you got an economy going. People didn't realize... Thank you. People forgot, unless there's some of us who are old enough to remember the Great Depression. I don't know. Is there anybody here old enough to remember? Okay. Do you remember local scripts? Do you remember that there was, in this country, over 1,000 local scripts created during the Great Depression? Communities got together and created some kind of money system because there was no more of these. Does anybody remember? And some of them were backed by sheepskin, some were backed by wheat. Some were backed by nothing at all except each other. And that's what kept the infrastructure together while the rest of the system was busy off there trying to figure out how they were going to take our property and bankrupt us all. But the people are very adaptive, and I think we'll be adaptive again. I think we're going to find the time is coming when these are going to continually shrink, if not disappear altogether, into either some credit, debit, computer type system, or simply just be devalued to the point where the buying power is so little that you can't get what you need with them, that they'll follow the pace of the peso, the root of the peso. And I believe this will happen in short time, that the dollar is going to free fall. Remember, the central banks aren't going to float the value of the currency anymore. They already decided they will not buy treasury securities anymore. It means that the U.S. dollar has to compete on the international currency market with all the other currencies out there. And the true value of a currency is related to the true productivity of the nation. So if we're all busy at war here and all fighting each other and we're all sitting at our desk pushing paper around and we're not really producing anything, the value of this is going to go down to its true market value, which could be 10 cents on the dollar. And it could just go down to just, you've heard the old story, you have to get a whole bushel basket full of $20 bills to buy a loaf of bread. I mean, that isn't unusual. The average life of a currency on the planet is 7 years of a paper inflatable currency. We've had an exceptionally strong currency for a long time, but that's because of the nature of our country and the strength of the productivity, but also the plan that the New World Order has had for us has been special in this world because we're the only people who still have that sovereignty right here. It's right there, and it's alive and well. We might have to dust it off a little bit. We might have to practice a little bit more, start behaving like sovereigns a little bit more than we are, take a lot more responsibility than we have in our lives, stop depending on other people, stop pointing the finger at other people and blaming other people for your problems, stop being a victim, start being responsible. We're all responsible. And that's the beginning of the values and the virtues that we need to reestablish in order to get the Constitutional Republic back in order again. And it's going to come and rise up out of the people, out of necessity, but also out of a spiritual vision that we can, in fact, that we must. We're compelled. We're compelled by what is right, by what is true, and by the natural law and by God's law to do so. So just briefly, how's our time getting here? We got about 10 minutes? Okay, we're perfect then. Perfect timing. I've got to talk a little bit about the legal system because I have not said a lot about it. But as you'll see, it relates perfectly and correlates to the political system and also the economic system. When the country went bankrupt the first time, we went off of the common law. Prior to 1938, all the law that was practiced was common law, which is constitutional law, which was case law, which meant common law meant you had due process, jury trials. As long as there were sovereign people and there was common law and there was a valid money system, the republic was in order. As long as you had the sovereign people, the sovereign states, and the common law, and a constitutional money system, the republic is in order. When the sovereign people begin disappearing, when the country goes bankrupt, then the common law disappears, and then you have negotiable instruments law or bankruptcy law. Ever since 1938, we've been dealing in the Uniform Commercial Code, negotiable instruments law, law of the law merchant, the international law of the high seas, and the law of the creditor is admiralty jurisdiction, maritime procedure. The sovereigns do not exist on the land. They exist on the sea, in between nation states, in legal structures that exist under admiralty and maritime. All the power structures that are sovereign do not have allegiance to nation states. The nation states are their servants. They are created as ships of state to execute the sovereignty. The sovereign powers have always used the admiralty jurisdiction and maritime procedures to execute their procedures. That is the only thing going on in the courts today. All issues of traffic, revenue, and insurance are admiralty. And in an admiralty proceeding, which most people don't understand because they can't conceive of it, they think that, one, we still have a constitution and a bill of rights and it's the law of the land and we have common law and we have rights and we have due process and there's actually procedures here that follow the constitutional standards. There are none. Remember, there is no constitution or bill of rights without the sovereign people. There is no common law in a bankrupt country. There's only admiralty law. In 1933, when the country went bankrupt, it declared a perpetual state of national emergency, which was bankruptcy. We have been in a perpetual state of national emergency since 1933. There have been 470 consecutive states of emergency without a breath for the Constitutional Republic to breathe. One executive order after another. Also, in a perpetual state of national emergency, the Constitution is suspended as well. And so what is being executed in the legal systems today under admiralty jurisdiction and maritime procedures? When you get a traffic citation, it is a maritime procedure. When they are impounding your property, it is a maritime procedure. When they have forfeited your land, it is a maritime procedure. But they don't tell you that. They play games and they pretend with you. The second they seize your property, they have executed an admiralty claim. They seized your vessel or your vassal. A vassal is a slave. You'll look on the California registration, you'll see the registration is for vessels. All of your property is a vessel, whether it's on land or on sea. And an admiralty proceeding is initiated at the moment that they seize your vessel or your body, which is their property, and a vessel as well, when they arrest you. In an admiralty proceeding, you cannot challenge jurisdiction. Jurisdiction is assumed the second they confiscate the property. Then what the courts do is they shift from admiralty to equity, without telling you. And now they perform under a quasi-contract. Because in an admiralty contract, if it was an admiralty jurisdiction, there would have to be a signed international contract in force. But they know there isn't one with your name on it. But there is one with the name of the Federal United States on it. And since you're a subject of the Federal United States, the Federal United States is subject to its creditors. The creditors are the insurance underwriters of the debt of the Federal United States, executing an admiralty claim in the court systems. Your accuser is the International Monetary Fund for a simple traffic citation. And who is the proctor? The proctor in an admiralty proceeding is a U.S. attorney. In fact, all the attorneys are proctors, acting on behalf of the creditors. In a bankruptcy, the Secretary of the Treasurer is a receiver in a bankruptcy who is also the governor of the International Monetary Fund. The U.S. Attorney General, Janet Reno, is not a U.S. citizen, and neither is the Secretary of the Treasurer. They both expatriated in 1948 when they joined Interpol, the International Police Organization, by treaty. And they transferred their allegiance to the International Police Organization. So the International Police Organization, Interpol, is the police arm of the creditor, the International Monetary Fund, and they are your accusers. They're trying to collect on a debt that the federal government owes and you owe because you're a U.S. citizen. So that's about as much as I can really talk about that without getting much more in depth, but it was a profound insight when we finally realized that we need to develop admiralty strategies for reclaiming within the court systems under maritime procedures by filing cross claims. They claim that they own my vessel. Well, I'm another owner. I claim that I'm the owner of my vessel because I'm a sovereign citizen, and I'll file a cross-claim in admiralty. In which case, when I do, it shifts back from equity back into admiralty again. Now they have to produce the international contract with my signature on it, which they cannot do, and they may balk, and they may cry, and they may scream, and I will answer their screams and their cries, but I will show no mercy, because when I'm done with them, when I'm done with them, I will file a cross libel, which will then shift it from an admiralty to a common law. And a cross libel will then be directed individually at everyone involved in the fraud, from the judges and the attorneys and all of them. And then the First Judiciary Act and what's called
Savings to suitors. The Savings to Suitors Clause of the First Judiciary Act of 1789 then comes into effect. And these are being developed now as a higher level strategy to get accountability in the courts. And that's what we're working on now. So next time I come back, I'll report on how we did on the cases that we're proceeding. And I think our time is probably about up. And I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Yeah, we can take questions.
We're going to have a quick question and answer. We'll take about 8 minutes. We have a microphone set up right here in the back. Ron, if you'll take this microphone, we're going to have a double mic. Anybody has any questions?
Will you go back and handle my book table? All the books are 30, the new service is 5.
A question for Johnny. Not editorials. I don't want to hear your life history and what you've done. Questions for Johnny only. If you get into an editorial, we'll cut the sound. So if you'll step right up here, and Johnny, you're right. I'm taking it. Over here, please.
Okay. I guess we're going to go find the microphone here. After the question period, I'm going to be behind here for some time, and I'll have books back there and other things, and we can talk later. So let's go with the first question.
Can you address the difference between being a resident and citizen? Sometimes I might explain things to people. They never seem to understand that. It's kind of something you didn't touch on. The legal definition of a resident versus a citizen.
Okay, it might help clarify that a resident is a corporate citizen with a little c. What you are as a sovereign citizen with a big C is you are domiciled in a state, or you are an inhabitant, a free inhabitant of that state. That's how you refer to yourself and make the distinction clear. A resident is a corporate citizen by definition.
How do you know if, like I bought my own property and built my house on it, how do I know if it's, what do you call it, allodial in my name? Or is owned by the state?
You can assume that it is owned and controlled by the state if you have a deed and haven't updated the land patent.
I have a grant deed.
You have a grant deed? Yeah, it's the same thing. It's still a deed. It's one of the many different types of deeds. What you need to do is update the land patent from the BLM, which used to be the land patent office. You get an original copy, and then you rewrite the legal description, and then you file it back with the county recorder. And that's how you update the land patent. You give them notice to anybody with an equity interest in the property. They have 60 days to challenge you in court. If they don't, it is automatically updated.
How do you give them notice?
You give them notice by either publishing it in a legal publication for a period of time, or you actually send them a notice in the mail.
During the Civil War, it's very confusing. The prince, the Prince of England, who was the son of the King of England, was with the Southern Army, the Confederate Army, the Rebel Army. And it seems like the monarchy of England was for the South, but then they were supposed to be controlled by the banks of Europe.
I think there's some exceptions to that. From my my studies, the Bank of England was the primary sovereign behind the North and the Bank of France behind the South. Now, there might have been some personal family differences going on.
Yeah, they helped us in the Revolution, too.
Right. Yeah, so.
If you've gotten a passport 8 or 10 years ago and you made the mistake of filling out with a Social Security number or making other mistakes, if you go down and get a new passport, can that be corrected from any errors you may have made in the past? Yes. Is that a record there that stays forever?
There is no record that stays forever. Anything that is done under mistake or error or under fraud or under misrepresentation or not full disclosure, you can revoke. And so if you've made a mistake in the past and entered into contracts that you really didn't understand the implications, you can revoke them. And you can revoke your signature, for example, on a traffic citation. If they force you to sign it under threat of arrest, you can either revoke it right there on the spot by putting without prejudice UCC 1-207 in the box, or the next day you can file an affidavit with the county recorder revoking your signature.
I'd like to know what suggestions you have as to what's important, most important, in your opinion, for us to do at this time, personally on a small level and then a bigger level also. Thank you.
Love your neighbors as yourself. The golden rule applies. Stockpile a certain amount of food and water and other items, and a surplus of certain things that you want to be able to trade with your neighbors, so that you really look out for your neighbors and everybody in your area. I think that's the most important thing. And then if you've got a little piece of extra energy left around, then you might want to confront the power structure in some regard. But begin by getting the home and the family and the community in order so that you can have a support group.
I'd like to make a comment on what you just said. The Los Angeles County Recorder will not record anything unless they had an original document that you had filed years ago. Then they will revoke the you can revoke the signature on it. Now they will not record any new document.
Well, the Los Angeles County Recorder has been inundated with state citizens for so long, they finally got wind that people are actually getting the rights back. So what has to happen is the county recorder has to be taken to task and sued, because the California codes specify very clearly what the performance of the county recorder is, and they are violating the law, and thus they need to be sued and taken to task for it. So that's what you need to do. And it's just another hurdle, but it's one that's going to have to be jumped over. They're not obeying the law.
My question is, why do we have, what's the reasons for the national debt?
The reason for the national debt? The national debt is a fiction. It doesn't really exist. It was created as a bookkeeping ledger, basically, to convince everybody to work real hard all of their life and end up with nothing and have it all transferred into the hands of a few people. It's a complete fiction. Whether it's a $15 trillion debt or a $5 trillion debt or a $50 debt, it makes no difference. We have to repudiate it, and basically as though it doesn't exist, because it doesn't really exist. And every contract that has been generated since the country went bankrupt is also a fraud and can be repudiated.
I just wanted to comment on when you were referring to the Civil War and the Confederacy. There were some English constituents who were behind the Confederacy. They were just there waiting for a decisive victory of the Confederacy before they did something about the naval blockade and so forth. I just wanted to...
Oh, good. I'm sure there are. I'm sure there's a lot of exceptions to the generalizations. Indeed.
Tell us a little bit about yourself and the organization that you represent, if there is one.
Well, myself, I'm a whole systems educator, a researcher, and a teacher, and a writer. And the organization, the Cascadian Resource Center, is more of a network than it is an organization. We have about 105 different researchers around the country, and we collaborate with each other to try to share information, particularly in the areas of litigation and developing legal strategies. That's our primary focus right now in terms of action.
I'm working with some Republicans on consideration of how to write up the voter registration, and I'm trying to put common sense in here to apply to patriots. Obviously, let's put it this way, the state citizens have an angle of which I think should have consideration here. Is there a way that the state citizen movement, those involved in state citizen, can vote under a given circumstance? Could the registration be written in a way in which the state citizen could feel comfortable without compromising their position?
I suppose it's possible to do so. The voting, as we know have it in the forms, are only for United States citizens. Now, either the county elections department needs to be ordered to create the appropriate forms for the state citizens, number one, or the U.S. citizen forms, which unfortunately are a hidden contract, too. They not only register you to vote, but they make you obligate you to the county, state, and municipal bonds. That is a contract, the voter registration. So you don't want to have that come along for the ride, so you wouldn't want to just simply cross out U.S. citizen and put state citizen, then the state citizen would be obligated to the bond. So either you've got to get the proper form work, or the state citizens need to re-inhabit the Electoral College, which was there as a check and balance against the popular vote. That's where state citizens actually were. The sovereign people were the electoral colleges at one point, and they had veto power over the popular vote.
Now, I need actual black and white proposal for the for wording on a registration for voting that those who are out of the system for various means would feel comfortable in signing. So I'm open for suggestions, because I'm making suggestions myself, I'm doing thinking. So if anybody has anything to offer in that area, it would be appreciated.
Thank you so much.
Give Johnny a big hand on that.